Welcome to Backstage with Portland Choir and Orchestra. This is our podcast series where we pull back the curtain on some of our performances and take a closer look at the music, its background, its meaning, and why we thought our audience would like it. Today's theme, movie music for choir and orchestra. I'm joined by Dr. Edward Higgins, Orchestra Director of Portland Choir and Orchestra. Hello, Ed.
Hi, Brad. Nice to be with you again.
And I'm your host, Brad Goodwin. Each episode, we choose music on a theme and look back through our archives to find examples from our performances that correspond to that theme. Today's theme is movie music for choir and orchestra, and we'll be examining several performances of music from the movies. We have performed a lot of movie music over the years, and we'll showcase several of them today, from Disney movies to John Williams classics to Broadway musicals that were made into movies. I think movie music is a really good fit for Portland Choir and Orchestra. We perform a lot of sacred choral music, but most of our repertoire is basically what used to be called classical pops and is now called classical crossover, arrangements of patriotic songs, Christmas carols, Broadway songs, and the like, music that's familiar and easily accessible to our core audience. And movie music often fits that description perfectly. Ed, as a conductor, why do you think movie music is so popular with our audience?
You have to go back to what was happening before film, which was opera. For example, in Italy, everybody loved the story. And I think if you take that and, you know, move it forward to when we had electronics, then it makes a natural sense that we would love a movie music. Our contribution in the United States is adding film and movies. So there's that. And also, it's just simply everybody loves a story. So when someone hears a reference such as a theme, then it reminds them of that story.
You know, I had not thought of the opera connection before. And I think you're onto something there. I mean, maybe there was something before opera, but if you take a through line from opera to operetta to musicals to movies, it really is about attaching music and visuals together, and that has proved itself to be very appealing to people.
Absolutely. It just, the music just enhances the senses and heightens the experience.
All right, well, let's get to our first topic today, Disney movies. Disney movies provide a really rich set of opportunities for an organization like ours. Many, if not most of their movies are essentially musicals. They're full of catchy lyrics and memorable melodies, and they're perfect for a choir and orchestra to perform. Over the years, we've performed songs from Sleeping Beauty, Aladdin, Mary Poppins, Pocahontas, The Lion King, and Enchanted as well. In fact, if you watch the last episode of Backstage with Portland Choir and Orchestra, we featured our performance of Enchanted Medley from the movie Enchanted. It's a delightful little arrangement that includes some fun choir choreography. There's a link to that episode in the description below, and I encourage you to check it out. Today, we're going to share some Disney music that was performed in 2012 with acclaimed recording artist and concert violinist Jenny Oakes Baker. It was our second collaboration with her, and we performed several selections from her Grammy-nominated album, Wish Upon a Star, a tribute to the music of Walt Disney. Here's a short excerpt of Once Upon a Dream from the 1959 animated classic, Sleeping Beauty.
Thank you.
Jenny Oakes Baker, who you just saw, has performed around the world as a violin soloist, has been featured on television and radio broadcasts nationwide. She's collaborated with the likes of Gladys Knight and Marvin Hamlisch. Her music has been featured in several films, and she's released 18 studio albums. And in addition to all that, and touring as a soloist, Jenny now performs with her four children as the group Family of Four. And I'm delighted to have Jenny joining us today. Hi, Jenny.
Hi.
You know, I was looking over your albums as I prepared for our conversation. I couldn't help but be impressed by the breadth of your repertoire. Classical music, Christian hymns, sacred music, Broadway, Christmas carols, movie music, pop music. I actually had written that much, and then I went through and began actually looking at all the songs. Pop music was added, rock, opera, patriotic, and something I'm deciding to call bluegrass, or maybe it's at least jug band or something like that. I don't know what to call it, but that's quite a range. How do you choose your music?
I really just try to listen to the spirit about what the Lord would have me record next. And Heavenly Father is really lovely to give me good direction. And my next album, I feel really strongly about, I can't talk about it yet, but Kurt Bester, I've worked with for over 20 years, and he and I kind of were going down this road for a new album, and we spent a lot of time on it. And I just started I felt like it wasn't the right album. And it was a great idea, and we had it all fleshed out, and Deseret Book, my record label, had approved it, and we were about to push go, and I just felt like it wasn't the right album for me, at least at this time. And so we just started over from scratch, and I felt very, very strongly that my next album that will come out around Easter time is exactly what the Lord would have me record next. So I'm really excited about it, and I'm just grateful that the Spirit always guides me.
Well, you know, I want to ask about that, because one of the questions I had coming into this is there a Jenny Oakes Baker sound? And I'll tell you my opinion in a minute, but as far as I can discern, the music on your albums is always a custom arrangement. You know, you're not doing Paganini. If you are doing Paganini, it's
My first few albums, I did a few classical tunes that I just got, you know, straight from Juilliard Library or, you know, whatever music store. So in the beginning, because I'd been raised entirely as a classical violinist. And so in the beginning, about half my albums were new arrangements and about half were classical tunes that I'd played, you know, in church or whatever. And, but then I started to just fall in love with especially Kurt Bester's sound. And I really feel like Kurt Bester's sound is my sound, at least what he writes for me. He does a lot of jazz on his own. That's not really my sound. But and his is maybe more new agey, that's not my sound, but what Kurt Bester has written for me is really epic and heavenly and full of spirit and lush and of like emotional and inspirational. And that's what I hope is just that heavenly inspirational feel. The love of God is the hope that I have my sound is. Clearly, Bester is your man. Kurt and I, he's been, in the beginning, I worked with a lot of different arrangers on my first like three or four albums. And I just started giving Kurt, in the beginning, I gave everyone one song. And then I I started giving Kurt two or three songs and everyone else one song. And then I started giving Kurt half the album and a few other people one song. And then all of a sudden I was just like, all Kurt. And I mean, 10 of my last albums have been all Kurt Bester, and he knows how to write for me. And the way he's able to just create exactly what my soul wants to play is pretty incredible.
My take is that there is a Jenny Oakes Baker sound, and that it might be described as, you know, someone might say it's just classical crossover, and that's the easy way to say it. But I think it's much more than that. You take familiar standards in any genre, and then you pair it with a lush orchestral arrangement, and then top it off with, you know, virtuoso violin solos. And what you end up with is a very audience-friendly product, but it also challenges the audience to come along with you on a sometimes kind of progressive musical journey, you know, not just sit there passively and listen.
I hope that my sound is more than just virtuosic. It really, there's a lot of virtuosos out there, and there's a lot of great orchestral writing, and there's a lot of classical crossover, but I hope my music is more, and I think it is. It really, I know that God didn't give me a talent just to be known as a great violinist. I know that he gave me a talent so I could convey his love for his children on earth. There's lots of good violinists out there, but I hope that my music can do more than just impress or entertain. I've always felt like music was my mission, and I kind of came to understand that that's just a vehicle. Music is just a vehicle for me to bring people closer to Christ. We all have different vehicles that we can fulfill our missions. And so music is just a vehicle, and it's my favorite vehicle.
You know, I mentioned earlier that you have been a special musical guest with Portland Choir and Orchestra on two occasions. Do you enjoy these kind of guest artist appearances?
I love them. You guys need to have me back. It's been a long time. I really love them. I love performing music with people that have the same kind of goal in mind as far as like bringing people closer to God. And it's a really special memory, and really special shows, really talented musicians and instrumentalists and singers and conductors. And I hope to come back.
You know, I remember back in our 2012 concert, I was the stage manager back then, and one of my jobs was to go to your green room and let you know when it was time to come to the stage. I'd go back to the green room and I'd find you intensely practicing the solos that you were about to perform on stage. And I don't think it occurred to me until a lot later that, unlike the orchestra, you perform without music. It's all memorized. And as a soloist, you're playing hundreds and thousands of notes all by yourself, you know, from the front of the the stage. So I actually checked the other day. There are about 300 Jenny Oakes Baker songs on Apple Music. So I think you'd be terrified that you're going to forget big parts of your solos. How do you do it?
Well, you practice, and I mean, I it's like you practice, pray, and there's another P. I practice, and maybe it's just two. I practice and I pray. I pray really hard. I try to behave myself. And then once in a while, like, especially, I don't know, I've found as I get older, if I have a lot going on, like sometimes there's just not the headspace to memorize a new song. And so once in a while, I'll just pull out a music stand. I'm kind of giving myself that license now that I'm a little older once in a while. And I try to memorize everything, but once in a while, it's like new, and I'm just like, my headspace is not there, and there's too many notes and I'm doing too many things. And so I just will pull out a music stand once in a while.
Do you have any current musical projects you're working on that you want to tell people about, or direction, new ideas that you're comfortable talking about?
Yeah, so I'm performing at Tuacon, which is a huge outdoor venue in Southern Utah. It's just like red rocks, it's gorgeous. So we're doing a Christmas concert November 20th there with Scott Children's Choir and high school choir and two dancing groups and my family. So I perform a lot with my family as well. So that's coming up, hope people can come. And also, I'm recording, and in the spring, I'm recording a new album with my children. My oldest daughter's on a mission. She comes back end of March, so we're going to record her really quick. And then my second daughter is at the Royal Academy of Music studying piano for college. And she comes back in April, so we're going to record an album really quick. So it'll be a Jenny Oakes Baker and Family 4 album out this summer. And then I have a solo project being released by Deseret Book in April. So those things should keep me pretty busy the next few months at least.
Well, thank you, Jenny Oakes Baker, for joining us today, and best wishes to you and your family.
Well, thank you. Great talking to you. Have a good night.
All right. One thing that I think is interesting is that the Disney songs from Jenny's album that we played were instrumental pieces. They had no singing on them at all. And since we're a choir and orchestra, we wanted to showcase the choir as well. So we actually added choir parts to the existing arrangements. And it was our orchestra director at the time, Joseph Hoffman, who added the choir parts. I found that fascinating. In fact, I have Joseph Hoffman, who's joined me to talk about it. Hi, Joseph.
Hi, Brett.
What was it like performing with Jenny Oakes Baker?
Jenny Oakes Baker is a true artist. It was a treat to work with her. She was demanding. She really knew what she wanted. And so she kept me on my toes. She really pushed me, challenged me, but it was a lot of fun. I would do it again.
Tell me a bit about your stint as an orchestra director.
Let's see. I think it was a short stint. I was with the organization for just 2 or 3 years, but I think we had a great time. I loved rehearsals each week. We worked hard. It's a total volunteer organization, as everyone knows, and these are very dedicated musicians. And recruitment was a constant theme. We had to keep those seats filled. Sometimes we're like, oh, do we have 2 percussionists tonight, or 4 percussionists, or 2.5, or, you know. But that's the nature of a volunteer organization. But we made great music. It was a lot of fun.
You know, a lot of the orchestra members, well, I shouldn't say a lot, a sizable number, I'll just say that, of the orchestra members that were in the orchestra then, 10 years ago, are still with the orchestra today.
Wow.
And I think that's a testament to, you know, the kind of music and the kind of programming that David Thomas does for this organization, but also to the enjoyment and the satisfaction that they get from performing with us.
Yeah, lots of dedication in that organization. I was always blown away just how many hundreds of hours get put in every year.
Tell me about some of the musical projects that you have in the works.
Right now, I'm putting most of my time into my website, hoffmanacademy.com. I am enjoying teaching students all around the world. I have a series of video lessons that I've recorded, and it's a series that takes you all the way from your very first song, Hot Cross Buns, all the way up to playing Bach and Mozart and more advanced pieces. And it's been super fun. We'll get videos from kids in India or the Philippines or the island of Malta. We had one student, and they're learning the piano. It's been so much fun to connect with people around the world, especially during COVID, where so many people couldn't go face-to-face with a piano teacher. We've hopefully been helping people keep making music in their homes.
One of your students is my grandson, 10-year-old grandson, James, who I was showing him a video of the choir in performance one day, and he saw you conducting, and he's like, that's my teacher. In fact, if you look at the comments of our YouTube video of Battle of the Heroes, you'll see some of your other students.
Oh, cool.
They somehow, you know, like some kid, some Star Wars kid, he's like, oh yeah. And he's looking at him going, wait a minute. And you can see in the comments, that's Mr. Hoffman. So they were excited to find you there too.
That's fun. Yeah, my boys, so I have 2 boys, and you know, you're just dad to them. But I think I finally got some cool or street cred with my boys when we were in the airport one time, and like a kid sees me and it's like, you're Mr. Hoffman. They like recognize me just randomly in the airport. And my boy's like, oh, wow.
Listen, thank you so much for spending some time with me today.
It was a lot of fun. Thanks, Brad.
Our next topic is the movie music of John Williams. John Williams, of course, is one of the most accomplished and revered motion picture composers of all time. Over the years, we've performed musical numbers from Home Alone and Home Alone 2, from Far Away, Amistad, Jurassic Park, and 2 of the Star Wars movies, The Phantom Menace and Revenge of the Sith. Williams has been nominated for 52 Academy Awards and has won 5 times. He's also won 7 BAFTA and 4 Golden Globe Awards. Oh, I forgot to mention, 25 Grammys, and 3 Emmys too. Ed, have you ever played under John Williams?
I haven't, but I do know some musicians who have. In fact, I must say that John Williams is one of those conductors slash composers, if you will, that musicians just love to play for. Not only do they love his music, he's just a wonderful person to collaborate with. There's this famous story of the tubist who played on the recording session for Close Encounters of the Third Kind. This gentleman's name was Tommy Johnson. He was the first call tubist for the Los Angeles studios, and he got hung up in traffic. And you know, when you're a studio musician, you really don't know what you're going to see when you get there. And musicians like to warm up, and especially on high pressured places, or if they're going to play high pressured passages. So in this case, you have to envision the recording session where it's completely filled with string players. And Tommy gets lost, or not lost, but he gets stuck in traffic, and he's trying to get to the recording session, and there's just a major traffic jam in Los Angeles. So finally, they were kind of waiting on him, because the tuba starts out the whole film score with that five-note theme. And so what happened is Tommy gets there, and he just grabs the only tuba the most versatile tuba he has, because he doesn't have time to get his array of tubas, depending on what kind of music he's going to be asked to play. And he's got the wrong tuba for this piece. It starts at its really high notes, and Tommy has to walk in, and he sprinted there with his tuba. He gets there, and then he has to lift his tuba up over all the strings to get through, and wade through to get back to where the brass players are. And he sits down, and John Williams gets up to, and he's the first thing with this theme, and he has to do it unwarmed up, and you know, he's of course hurried, and he did it on the first take. And that theme that we hear every time I've seen that movie, I've thought about that and how hard and how difficult that must have been for him. But it was masterfully performed by Tommy Johnson. Played professionally both as a trumpet player and as a tubist, and to play that on a C tuba, you know, an orchestral tuba that you might play Wagner with, it was difficult. And yeah. But you know, there's only one Tommy Johnson.
Yeah, and there's only one John Williams, who, you know, is kind of known for really complex to the layperson who's listening, is just fantastic, emotional, you know, lush, sort of classic-y sounding music, but to the instrumentalist, these are really hard parts, lots of fast moving notes and big jumps and technical mastery that's needed. What is it about John Williams' music that makes it so appealing?
It's his language. You know, if you look back from the first film score, or I guess you'd call it a film score, it's a TV program that I know of, where John Williams shows up, is back with Gilligan's Island back in the early 60s. And if you look at the credits, it doesn't even say John Williams, it says Johnny Williams. And if you look at where he was at, and if you look at that music and then compare it to something like Close Encounters, and then you look at the language, and you look at how he has developed, it's pretty amazing, actually. You know, Gilligan's Island is a pretty simple film score. And then you get to these other mega scores that John Williams has done. There's no one like John Williams. And that's one of the reasons why the musicians like him. His music, not only is it wonderful to listen to, but it's very challenging to play for. And, you know, we musicians love challenges.
When choosing how to program a concert and choosing the music that you're going to play in the concert, yeah, you want to entertain the audience, but you also sometimes want to challenge the audience a bit, and you have to challenge your musicians, or they don't, your singers and your instrumentalists, so that they get, I don't know if joy, but they get a reward from of growth from the music that they're performing. I've never thought of it that way.
There needs to be payoff, and it needs, at least for most, it needs to be artistic payoff. And with a score like John Williams, there's room for that. And there's room for you to stretch your musicianship.
John Williams includes choral parts in much of his music. Sometimes it's singing of actual lyrical storytelling, and sometimes it's just using the choir almost like another instrument, like a pipe organ, just with oohs and ahs or something like that. You might be surprised how many John Williams pieces fall into the first category. There's famous songs, at least famous to me, like Somewhere in My Memory and Star of Bethlehem, that both come from the Home Alone movies. Merry Christmas from Home Alone 2. There's a song called Dry Your Tears Africa from Amistad. You may remember the movie Hook. There was that song that the Lost Boys sing called I Don't Want to Grow Up. He has a go-to lyricist who's used a lot, Leslie Berkus, who I noted just died days ago. I saw on a website just in the last week has passed away. Here's a couple of short excerpts from our concerts. You'll find a link to the full performance in the description below. Pieces where Williams uses the choir almost as another instrument. Do you remember the 2002 Olympic theme he wrote, Call of the Champions? The choir sings words like Chitius, Altius, Fortius, the Olympic motto, but more like a percussion instrument than like a choir, and then spends the rest of the piece just singing along with the orchestra. It's beautiful and it's stirring as a theme. But I do remember thinking at the time that it was kind of a waste of the Mormon Tabernacle Choir's time, given that their part was so minimal. Here's another example of this kind of choral scoring by John Williams, Battle of the Heroes from Revenge of the Sith. As far as I can tell, the choir is simply awing the main theme in unison throughout. But the addition of the choir really imbues the battle scene with a sense of epicness that otherwise it wouldn't have. And so I think this use of the human voice in choir form really made sense for this piece. Let's listen to an excerpt of our performance of Battle of the Heroes. And remember, if you want to hear the whole thing, just click on the link in the description below. On to our last topic, movie musicals that started on Broadway. We dedicated an entire episode of Backstage with Portland Choir and Orchestra to Broadway, episode 5. And so if you like Broadway, I recommend you go watch that episode. I think we sang, or we showcased something like 19 different songs in that episode that we performed. And you'll find a link to that in the description below. But let's talk about movie music. We're going to focus on movies that were made from Broadway musicals, but there's been a lot of them. And in many cases, people know the movie even better than they know the Broadway musical. Ed, is there, as a conductor, is there anything you do differently when conducting movie music? Or is it pretty much the same as conducting any classical music number?
I'm always thinking about being more careful with a film score. And the reason why is because so many people have heard it. So, and will recognize it. So I need to be really careful not to get overly expressive, I guess. Maybe that's not the right word. Overly interpretive is the right word. So in other words, I don't really want to inflict as much interpretation of myself personally as I would with another genre of music. Mainly because the audience needs to recognize it, and they will recognize it. So I try not to veer off from that. In the same token, there's always a little bit that I try to put in, and just my own artistic expression, but I just have to be careful.
You know, I had never thought of that, but as you say it, I'm thinking, yeah. If you look on, I don't know where I might have seen this, maybe on Amazon, you know, music reviews or something, where somebody is commenting in the comment section about the Mahler ninth that is recorded by Bernstein, and they're like, Bernstein's interpretation is terrible, he takes it way too slow, and you're like, seriously, you're that into it that you're going to criticize how the speed that somebody plays a certain obscure classical number? But your point is, movie music is so well known that everyone's a critic, and you can't push the general public, you know, because they've heard it. They know what they're expecting it to hear to sound like.
I'm more careful with film scores than I am with musicals for that very reason. Film scores are all over, and everybody, well, virtually has listened to them and seen the score. The films. So. And less so with Broadway musicals, because there's just not everybody can get to New York or wherever.
Yeah, and come to think of it, in a lot of Broadway musicals, the focus is on the singer. mm-hmm. and the audience's eyes and their recollection of their memory of the earlier performance, the movie or the musical, is sort of based on the singer's interpretation, not so much the orchestra. But on film scores, while they're hearing your live performance, they're imagining the movie back in their head. And if those two don't match up, they might, you know, not like it.
Yeah, you know, the one thing that, you know, I might add is that there are a lot of film scores that, frankly, without the visual, are not particularly very interesting. Because it's not designed for that. It's really not designed for music to be just exclusively listened to. It's supposed to enhance, you know, what is going on in the film visually. So, you know, you have to be really careful there. But I always did that in the selection. I mean, I happen to know that there are film scores or at least concert adaptations of film scores that are, in my view, would not fit just because the music's just not interesting in it.
Well, for today's conversation, let's focus on two movies that were made from successful Broadway musicals. The first is Guys and Dolls, a 1955 American musical film starring Marlon Brando, Gene Simmons, Frank Sinatra, and Vivian Blaine. It is a delightful musical out of which came at least three songs that many of you know: Sit Down, You're Rockin' the Boat, Adelaide's Lament, and the one we're going to show you next, Luck Be a Lady. The song is sung by Marlon Brando in the movie, who hopes that he will win a bet, the outcome of which will decide whether or not he's able to save his relationship with the girl of his dreams. Here's an excerpt of a never-before-published performance of Luck Be a Lady, sung by the men of the choir with soloist David Robbins from our concert in June 2018.
They call you Lady Luck, but there is room for doubt. At times you have a very unladylike way of running out. You're on this date with me. The pickings have been lush. And yet before this evening is over, you might give me the brush. You might forget your manners. You might refuse to stay. And so the best that I can do is a pray.
Luck be a lady tonight. Luck be a lady tonight.
Next is a song from the 1972 musical film, Man of La Mancha. The original musical had 31 musical numbers, of which only one has really stood the test of time, The Impossible Dream. And boy, does it have legs. It's been recorded by dozens and dozens of recording artists over the years, from Frank Sinatra to Glen Campbell to Aretha Franklin to Josh Groban. The movie starring Peter O'Toole was based on a 1964 Broadway musical, which was itself based on a 1959 non-musical television play that was broadcast on the CBS network. Here's an excerpt from our 2018 performance of The Impossible Dream. You can find a link to the full performance in the description below. Well, thanks, Ed, for joining me today.
Great to be here, Brad.
And that brings episode 11 to a close. For our next episode, we're going to examine the top YouTube videos from Portland Choir and Orchestra. Please join me for our most popular YouTube videos next time on Backstage with Portland Choir and Orchestra.